Jewish minority to resist conquests and invasions by all the hordes or armies in this land for more than 20 centuries. 27 centuries.
Des différentes hordes ou même armées qui ont pu traverser ces régions.
And did they stay here? Even after the massacres, there was only one solution in the criminal logic of the Young Turks: eradication. A concept that Hitler would understand during the Second World War, when, having attempted to expel them, he eradicated the Jews of Europe by murdering them. Thus, eradication was the final solution to the Armenian question. The only definitive solution to the Armenian question. But unlike the events after National Socialism, or more recently after the war in Rwanda, the murderer held on to power. That is the problem. When all is said and done, the Armenian genocide benefited the murderer. And what Mustafa Kemal preserved in a crime he denounced when he did not yet hold power was the benefit of this crime, vital for the Turkey he dreamt of creating. That is, Eastern Anatolia, emptied of its Armenian population. There could never again be Armenians in Eastern Anatolia. There could never be any Armenian claim on Eastern Anatolia, and therefore genocide could never have happened. QED. It is interesting that in 1919, the Ottomans were defeated. An armistice was signed at Mudros, and a new government succeeded the Young Turks, who abandoned power at the end of 1918. This government was already in place at the end of 1918, and from the beginning of November 1918, it summoned Parliament, or what was left of it, in a bid to drag these criminals before a court of law. They were very briskly tried on the basis of documentation, which was already very extensive at the time.
But what led this government to want to actually try them?
The reason is very simple. It wanted to obtain satisfactory conditions for the peace conferences due to get underway at Versailles. The crimes committed were known to all in the international arena, particularly the Americans and Canadians. The documents were there. The crimes had been spoken of almost immediately. It was impossible to hide them. Therefore, their only solution was to blame the defeated government and the Young Turks. Turkey found itself with the old structure of the Ottoman Empire in 1919-1920, with the Sultan and the Grand Vizier, instead of this growth in nationalist spirit. The Turks came to the table in Versailles very cautiously, with the rope around their necks, as it were, especially the Grand Vizier, Damat Ferit Pasha, when he came to Versailles to request pardon for Turkey for the abominable crimes committed not by the Turkish people, but by the Young Turks.
De ces abominables crimes qui ne sont pas la faute du peuple turc, mais des jeunes turcs. D'où l'intérêt de faire des procès.
Thus, the advantages of the trials and the sentences. The process was facilitated by the fact that the majority of the Young Turks had already fled, especially to Germany. The death sentences were pronounced in absentia. The trials concluded that there could be no doubt that the premeditated and organized destruction of the Armenians in the Ottoman Empire was initiated at the highest level of the Party of Union and Progress. Rather than on the government, blame fell on this party, some of whose members were part of the government, such as the Minister for War and the Minister of the Interior, and in particular on the Party Central Committee. The trials highlighted the previously unknown and secret special organization. This structure operated between the center, the government of Constantinople, and the provinces, dispatching plenipotentiaries with supreme authority to make decisions, and whose authority extended to both the military and the civil authorities when they wanted to kill, arrest, or kill groups of Armenians.
Quand ils voulaient détruire ou arrêter ou détruire des groupes arméniens.
The trials revealed this special organization. And in hindsight, as the word genocide only appeared in 1944, the proof that this was truly genocide. The concerted plan was laid bare with all its workings, all the details, and all the interference by various ministries. Bands of militia were recruited in the prisons, organized and armed by the war ministry and sent out. Relationships existed with the population and specifically with groups such as the Kurds and so on. All of this information was uncovered during the trials.
A moment ago, you said that the Ottoman archive concealed many lies, but didn't they also provide material?
This is a far more complicated issue, because there was a search for documents throughout the Ottoman Empire before the trials, and we have to come back to the work of the Mazar Commission. Mazar Bey was a Vali who refused to collaborate with the deportation of the Armenians. Therefore, he was entrusted with recovering documents where he knew they existed, as officially, these documents had to be destroyed. Documents were mainly telegrams, code telegrams. Nonetheless, it was possible to decode them, but the commission demanded they be immediately destroyed. However, people often kept them to be able to prove that they were not directly responsible for the acts perpetrated, that they had acted on orders. Taled Bey had been a Posts and Telegraphs employee and had in-depth knowledge of this system. He had a telegraph in his own home, from which he sent maybe hundreds of telegrams every day. His main work was communicating with the provinces by telegram. So, all the threads of this web of genocide come together, or start, if you prefer, at the Ministry for the Interior and telegrams. For the most part, they have disappeared, except for some which were kept and produced during the trials. I don't know if there are any still preserved in the Ottoman archives, but we do know they were published in the official journal of the time. They were also reproduced in French newspapers. There were some in Constantinople at the time. Therefore, the available documentation is totally reliable. The word genocide was invented in 1944 by Raphael Lemkin, a legal expert who researched the content of this aspect of international law. His definition of the word and its full meaning were put before the Convention of December the 9th, 1948, and unanimously adopted by the UN General Assembly concerning the prevention and repression of the crime of genocide. This was a pivotal moment in international law after World War II. Three different criminal entities were defined. I would even say 3 degrees of war crimes and crimes against humanity. Concepts which had figured during the Nuremberg trials, and genocide, now defined as separately as the ultimate crime, the crime of crimes, this crime that Churchill spoke of in 1941, when he began to denounce the Nazis' crimes. And that brings us down to the depths of the horror man is capable of inflicting on his fellow man. The truth about the Shoah was to be revealed very gradually and would lead obviously to other victims to ask themselves the question. And very soon, from 1945, we see Armenian journalists like Shavash Mzakian writing genocide, a genocide article saying, "We too were victims of the genocide." There was a growing realization that by studying the events in detail, by studying what happened in 1915 and 1916 historically, this crime that was once called the massacres, or what for the Armenian people was the catastrophe, which is the literal meaning of the word Shoah, constituted genocide. So that nations must take the responsibility to acknowledge a historical truth, that of genocide.